Welcome back. In the last class, we discussed about the index properties, and we come to know that what is index property, what are all the index properties, and we listed the index properties. The various index properties are the color of soil, the grain specific gravity, the moisture content, field density, relative density, particle size distribution or grain size analysis, and consistency of soil. Also, we discussed about the color of soil and the shape of the soil. Now, in this class, let us learn about the grain specific gravity. And it is denoted by capital G. As we already aware and know that specific gravity is defined as the ratio of weight of the given volume of soil to the weight of equivalent volume of water is known as specific gravity. The specific gravity term which already we used in order to establish relationships among the various terminologies. Now here we learn how to determine specific gravity. So, based on definition, specific gravity is defined as the ratio of the weight of given volume of soil to the weight of equivalent volume of water. It is an important index property which can be used to determine other properties such as void ratio, the degree of saturation, the unit weight, water content, etc. So, as per the definition of specific gravity, G is equal to the unit weight of soil solids by unit weight of water is known as specific gravity. So, this can also be written as unit weight of soil solids is nothing but WS divided by VS into gamma W. So, WS divided by VS is nothing but unit weight of soil, and this is gamma W. As we know already that it is specific gravity is an important index property. It can be used to decide the type of soil. The value of specific gravity ranges between 2.65 to 2.85. If the soil possesses organic matter in a considerable amount, the value may keep on reducing below 2.65, even it may be less than 2. On the other hand, if the soil possesses heavy metals, depends upon the metal present in the soil, the value of specific gravity goes on increases from the higher limit of 2.85, and even sometimes it crosses the 3. This can also be used, means specific gravity can also be used to classify the soil. Higher the value of specific gravity means fine grained soil, and lower the value of specific gravity means coarse grained soil. And the value in between range, it's a moderate soil. So, like this, we can decide the type of soil. As it is an important index property, it is very much required to know the specific gravity of a particular soil which we come across in field when we use for application purpose as a foundation material or as a construction material. As it is an important property, specific gravity of soil can be determined by using two methods in the laboratory, namely the pycnometer method and another one is density bottle method. The pycnometer method is already you have learnt in your third semester in basic material testing laboratory. There you have determined the specific gravity of coarse aggregate and the fine aggregate, and there we have treated the coarse aggregate as gravel and the fine aggregate as sand. Here in soil, as we are not going to distinguish as the soil, or we are not going to differentiate the soil as a coarser material or finer material. Of course, for the purpose of understanding, we are differentiating soil, or we are classifying soil as a coarse grained soil and fine grained soil, but still irrespective of the size of the particles, we treat the particle as soil. It may be a larger in size or it may be a smaller in size. So both the pycnometer method and density bottle methods are used to determine the specific gravity of soil, depends upon the soil which we come across in the practice. The suitability of these methods. Pycnometer method is most suitable for coarse grained soil. And density bottle method is most suitable for fine grained soil. And as you already come across the shape of the specific gravity bottle and the pycnometer method, the pycnometer is the resemblance is like this, having a wide opening at the top, so that you can place any size of the particle inside the pycnometer, whereas the density bottle method, it is it resembles like our Bunsen burner, or it is like a bulb-like bottle having a narrow neck like this. There is a constraint here to place the soil particle in density bottle method. Because of this constraint, generally we use a density bottle method to determine specific gravity of fine grained soil, whereas there is no constraint to place the soil particle in the pycnometer method. We can use this for almost all type of soil. In general, in particular, we can use this for determining specific gravity of coarse grained soil. Next, as per the accuracy is concerned, so this is less accurate, that is pycnometer method is less accurate, and density bottle method is more accurate. Here the volume involved is less, the volume involved is more. The accuracy of specific gravity determined purely based on the effective removal of entrapped air. Entrapped air means, to determine specific gravity of soil, we have to use soil invariably, both in pycnometer as well as in density bottle method. Along with soil, we also use water. When both soil and water is used, there are every chances of air entrap. When we add water to soil, there is the entrap of air. We need to remove those entrapped air to obtain the actual weight of soil, or actual weight of soil and water, or actual weight of water alone. Otherwise, whatever the value we determine, it is an apparent one. Hence, the accuracy of specific gravity determination depends purely on the effective removal of entrapped air, in both in case of pycnometer method and density bottle method. Now, having understood about the suitability of the methods and the accuracy of the methods, let us know how to determine, or let us learn how to determine specific gravity by using these two methods. The procedure we adopt for both the case is same, both in pycnometer method and density bottle method, we use the same procedure, except that here we use pycnometer, and here it is we use density bottle. First of all, we have to take soil for which specific gravity is required. The soil should be dry soil, and it should be free from organic matter. And if at all, if there are heavy metals, traceable heavy metals are there, it is preferable to remove those heavy metals. Then that dry soil we have to consider. For both the cases, we take dry soil passing 4.75 millimeter ISC. Take considerable amount of 4.75 millimeter passing dry soil. Next, pycnometer we know, along with soil we have to take the weighing balance. The weighing balance accuracy shall be 0.001 gram. First, we have to note down the empty weight of pycnometer or density bottle along with lid, and that should be noted as W1. Next, place soil in the pycnometer or density bottle approximately to a height of 1/3 height. Approximately to 1/3 height of the pycnometer or the density bottle, and place the lid over the bottle. Note down the weight of pycnometer plus soil, or weight of density bottle plus soil. It is W2. Next, add water almost up to the neck of the pycnometer and density bottle. Stir it well so that there is a formation of uniform soil water suspension. Then add water till the top of the pycnometer or density bottle. Observe the formation of bubbles at the top portion. If at all, if there are bubbles, water bubbles, keep on pouring water drop by drop until those bubbles formed at the top disappears. Likewise, repeat the procedure by filling water drop by drop, preferably by using the water filler or pipette to remove the entrapped air. In case of pycnometer, just by means of using this the pipette, we can remove the entrapped air. Whereas in case of density bottle, that too, if the soil is very fine grained in nature, it is somewhat difficult to remove the entrapped air. There we use the vacuum method of removal of entrapped air. There it adds the accuracy. Because of this small size and volume, it is possible to remove entrapped air effectively in case of density bottle method. As a result, there is increase in the accuracy. So after filling the pycnometer soil plus water, note down the weight of pycnometer plus soil and water, and that observation as W3. Next, empty the pycnometer, wash it thoroughly, fill it with the fresh water, place the lid at the top, and again fill water till it reaches to the brim, means up to the top. Wash the pycnometer outside and note down the weight of pycnometer plus water, and that will be recorded as W4. So by using these four observations, we can calculate the specific gravity of soil, and specific gravity is denoted by G. G is equal to W2 minus W1 divided by W4 minus W1 minus W3 minus W2. Here the numerator gives us the weight of the given volume of soil, and the denominator gives us the weight of equivalent volume of water. The same procedure is adopted even in case of the density bottle method, and again we use the same equation. Observations are same: W1 empty weight, W2 weight of the bottle plus soil, and W3 it is weight of bottle plus soil plus water, and W4 is weight of bottle plus water. Generally, the specific gravity is expressed in terms of two digits after point. In order to achieve higher accuracy, while determining specific gravity, it should be represented in three digits, and the difference between the different determination shall not be greater than 0.003. In other words, the specific gravity of the soil is decided based on three or four determinations on a fresh soil sample. The objective of taking three or four determination is approximation error encountered due to approximations while selecting soil for each determination, and the weight, the water filled, all will be taken care. So average of three or four determination is taken as the specific gravity of particular soil. And after, while determining and after deciding the average, we observe the difference between different determinations. The difference in value shall not be greater than 0.003 between successive determinations. So whichever the determinations is finds irrelevant, that determination will be discarded, and the determinations which falls within the range of this 0.003 will be treated as the acceptable value and considered for the averaging the determination to obtain the specific gravity. So like this, we can determine the specific gravity of soil by using both the pycnometer method and the density bottle method. Now let us learn another index property. It is water content. Water content or moisture content. Water content can also be called as moisture content. It is an important index property. Already we have defined this, what is water content. Water content is used to determine other the properties such as again specific gravity, void ratio, degree of saturation, unit weight, etc. Like all other living human beings and animals, insects, water is most essential for even materials also. Of the various medicines available for curing patients, water is the most important medicine for both human beings and the insects or animals. In the same way, water is most important for materials also. Water plays an important role in the behavior of materials. For all the materials, in order to achieve their optimum strength or to exhibit their strength, certain amount of water is required. That certain amount of water is known as the optimum water content. With that water content, materials will exhibit their strength. Of course, even without or with minimum amount of water also, the material will exhibit strength, but cannot be possible to exhibit full strength. The full strength of material can be seen only at the optimum water content. And in some case, lack of water content leads to not acquiring the desired strength, and excess of water again leads to not incapability of the material. So the phenomena which you already studied, that it is particularly in concrete technology, in the last semester you have studied lack of water content in concrete leads to the segregation of particles. On the other hand, in excess of water content in concrete leads to bleeding. So segregation and bleeding both are undesirable properties. There should be an optimum water content to be added to concrete in order to achieve the desired strength. In the same way, so this optimum water content can be considered in soil also. Dry soil possesses a very good strength. If the dry soil is lubricated by adding the required amount of water content, because of that lubrication effect, it is possible to bring particle close with each other. When we bring particles close with each other, in turn there will increase in the integrity in terms, increase in the unit weight or density. As a result, there is increase in strength. So like this, we can compare the presence of water content in soil to the concrete. At the same time, if amount of water present in soil is in excess, soil behaves differently, depends upon the amount of water present, again depends upon the type of soil. Coarse grained soils will not have much affinity towards water, hence there is no much effect on coarse grained soil in the presence of water, whereas fine grained soil will interact closely with the water, and hence there is variations in the property in the presence of water. Hence, whether the soil is coarse grained or fine grained, whether the soil is used as a base material or as a construction material, it is very essential to know about the water content present in the soil or the amount of water to be added to the soil. Hence, it is necessitated to know how to determine the water content in the laboratory or how to determine quickly the water content in the field. Water content can also be called as the moisture content, laboratory moisture content or the field moisture content, laboratory water content or the field water content. Alternatively, we can use the moisture content in place of water content, and it is the denoted by small w. As we know, it is defined as the ratio of weight of water to the weight of dry soil, and it is denoted as WS divided by WW, and it is expressed in terms of percentage. So we learnt what is the importance of water content. Based on the amount of water present in soil, we can also decide the type of soil. In the beginning, we have grouped soil based on particle size. Soil possess particles greater than 75 microns are categorized as coarse grained soil, and soil smaller than 75 micron are categorized as fine grained soil. Obviously, in coarse grained soil, particles are less when compared to the fine grained soil. More the particle, more will be the voids, means gap. Lesser the particle, less will be the gap, means coarse grained soil possesses less number of voids. On the other hand, fine grained soil possesses more number of voids. Again, coarse grained soil possesses less void ratio, and the fine grained soil possesses more void ratio. That also we discussed already. When water added to the soil, it will search for the empty space, and also it will search for the gap. Wherever there is a gap, it will try to occupy that gap, and also number of gaps. As number of gaps are gap in terms of number, as the number of gaps are less in coarse grained soil and more in fine grained soil, water required to fill up those gaps is less in coarse grained soil and more in fine grained soil. This is one way. The other way, as the number of particles are less in coarse grained soil and more in fine grained soil, the surface area or specific surface area is more in case of fine grained soil and less in the coarse grained soil for the same weight of soil. Hence, water required to occupy the gap or to lubricate the soil in case of fine grained soil is more when compared to the coarse grained soil. That is second concept. And thirdly, fine grained soil particles, particularly the clay soils, particles possess electrical charges. To neutralize or to diffuse those electrical charges, clay particles will attract dipole atom water as per the requirement. Hence, the fine grained soil particles or fine grained soil will absorb more water than the coarse grained soil. So, with these three reasons, we can confidently say that the coarse grained soil possesses less water and fine grained soil possesses the more water for the same given weight of soil. Hence, based on the amount of water present in the soil, we can comfortably categorize or group the soil as coarse grained soil and fine grained soil. Hence, again, the coarse grained soil possesses less water holding capacity, and fine grained soil possesses more water holding capacity. So these are all the importance, and based on water content we can now classify soil. So because of this, this is an important index property. It is very essential to learn how to determine this water content and moisture content in the laboratory as well as in the field as per the requirements. This water content can be determined in the laboratory or in the field by using the following five methods. They are woven dry method, second one is pycnometer method, third one is sand bath method, fourth one, rapid moisturometer, and fifth one is torsion balance method. Depends upon the situation where we require the water content, so we can adopt all these methods. Of these various methods available, it is the woven dry method is the most commonly used method for all practical purposes and also for all the important the research and development and consultancy activities. That is because of its accuracy and easiness. The remaining methods, when this woven drying method is not possible to use to determine water content, alternatively we can go for the other methods, namely pycnometer method, sand bath method, rapid moisturometer method, and the torsion balance method. wandering method of determining water content involves in drying the soil in an oven at a controlled water moisture for a particular duration of time and determining the weight of wet soil, weight of dry soil, and hence the weight of the water. With these simple procedure and suitable observations, we can determine the water content both in the laboratory as well as in the field if facilities are available. Here the instruments or apparatus required are along with soil sample, a weighing balance of accuracy 0.01 gram, non-corrodable steel containers, and the electrostatically controlled oven to maintain a temperature of 105 to 110 degree centigrade. It can be determined easily with the simple procedures and observation. First of all, we have to take the sufficient number of container, stainless steel non-corrodable container. Usually in the laboratory, those containers are the numbered serially, both at the top as well as bottom means it is the lid and the cup having the same number, so that there shall not be any mismatch in the container and lid. So first of all, we have to note down the number of container. Next it is, so we have to note down the empty weight of container. Empty weight of container, that is equal to W1 gram. Next, the third observation is, we have to select the representative soil sample for water content determination. Selection of amount or quantity of soil for water content determination again requires the knowledge about the capability of soil to withhold water. As we already discussed that coarse soil will withhold less water, on the other hand fine soil will withhold more water. With this knowledge, we have to pick the soil sample for water content determination. If the soil is coarse in nature, we have to take soil sample of about 20 grams or 25 grams for water content determination. Suppose if the soil is of fine grain nature, you have to select soil less than 20 grams or 15 grams. So note down the weight of soil plus the container, that is W2. W1 is the weight of empty container along with lid. W2 is the weight of container plus soil along with lid again. Next, we have to use the oven, switch on the oven, and to maintain the temperature ranging between 105 to 110 degree centigrade. After bringing the temperature constant, we have to open the oven, again open the lid of the container, keep the lid below the cup, place it in the oven, close the door. And it has to be kept in the wet soil to be kept in the oven for a duration of 24 hours. Next, come tomorrow, take out the container. Definitely it will be a fried or dry soil. again after the container and soil comes to the room temperature, note down the weight of the container and soil, note it as W3. With these three observations, we can comfortably determine the water content. As we know that already, water content is defined as the ratio of weight of water to weight of dry soil. That is, W is equal to weight of water, means it is W2 minus W3. Weight of its soil plus container, this is weight of dry soil plus container. So, difference of these two gives us the weight of water. The divided by W3 weight of dry soil plus container and W1 is weight of the container. So, difference of W3 minus W1 gives us the weight of dry soil. W3 minus W1, that multiplied by 100, because we usually express water content in percentage. So, this simple procedure, we can comfortably determine water content. Again, in order to achieve high accuracy, generally we take or we consider the water content of the soil as two or three determinations. So, like this, we can determine water content by using the Vo and Ri method. The next class will learn how to determine moisture content by using the other methods.